as we've been in a series in the Psalms, we've been meditating just a lot on the redeemed of the Lord, telling their story and proclaiming his works. So we've had some testimonies along the way, and we're going to have a couple more today. So listen to Brady's story.
My name is Brady. I've been coming to Red Mountain Community Church for about 10 months. I'm here to share my experience with Jesus Christ. For a long period of time, I kind of just did whatever was convenient for me. Life, I would say, just kind of unfolded, and I did whatever was in front of me with no real sense of direction or purpose. I got married. I had two kids. Life changed quite a bit for me. Somewhere along the way, I kind of fell into a path of like where things just started getting darker and darker. I fell into addiction pretty hard. Was drinking and using drugs, and slowly but surely my life kind of started to fall apart. This was a time in my life where I was really lost, found myself in a darkness that I really don't feel like I can describe. There's no words for that. Just a feeling of being completely separated, not necessarily not being loved, but being unlovable. It was kind of in a place where I was done with life. So I had asked God to end it. That didn't happen the way I thought it would. So I prayed again to God to just do anything, but I just couldn't do what I was doing anymore. And next thing you know, I have these people falling into my life, guiding me and directing me towards God again. Some real miracles happened. Found myself in some really good places, and God just kept putting the right people in front of me. And that's when things began to change for me. I found myself in a recovery community, making recovery a priority. But more important than that was seeking God and getting a better understanding of what God meant to me. Ended up working in that field to help other addicts and alcoholics. I pretty much my whole life revolves around that now. My work, my job is about that. I live in a place where I work with other addicts and alcoholics as a house manager, and in that process of really seeking God, I was led to church, where I found that I reconnected with a God that I had thought was very judgmental, vengeful, and critical of me as a person if I didn't behave a certain way, that God did not love me, and I found that that wasn't true. I found that God is a father, and I'm his child, and that we're his children, and that's a very personal relationship, and it's okay that I'm human, and it's okay that I make mistakes, as long as I'm willing to try to be a different person, and I'm willing to accept God's help with that, and try to help other people. And some of my favorite parts of the Bible is when it talks about being in darkness and coming to light, because I relate to that. And I said just a little bit ago that there weren't words for me to describe the darkness that I found. Well, now today, I really don't have the words to describe the peace and the happiness that I found, the joy that God has given me, the sense of purpose and meaning that I have today, a real direction in my life. And I heard somebody once say, a speaker once say, that real success isn't just taking care of yourself or making things happen for yourself. Real success is adding value to other people's lives. And so today, I feel like I actually have the ability to do that and really help other people to find themselves and to really look to find a God of love and peace and happiness. So I'm grateful for the opportunity to be here to do this.
It's a great story from Brady, who's only been in our church for about 10 months. And it's important to hear these stories because there's another example of someone who has met Jesus in a very personal way, and it changed his life. It's important to share these stories, I think, and becoming increasingly important in our day and age, not because we want to make celebrities out of these people or give you the dramatic feel goods. We're not just looking for stories that are really tug on heartstrings or, you know, anything like that. We're wanting to share stories of people at Red Mountain and how God is bringing people from darkness to light. He is rescuing, and he is redeeming. And Brady will be the first to tell you, if you were to talk to him, he would be the first to tell you that his life is not without challenge. It's not like everything now is perfect. Now that he knows Jesus, he would be the first to tell you that he still has many challenges and many things that he has to grow in. And his path of growth is long, and he sees that journey. He's going to be the first to say, you know, I don't have everything figured out. But the important thing is to seek the Lord and live life dependently on him, to live life with him. We live in a world where God is actively and miraculously involved, changing people's hearts for the sake of his glory. And that's an amazing thing. And we come every Sunday to celebrate that. And Psalm 107 is going to give us all the more reason to talk about that. Our series in the Psalms is going to end today. We've just been looking at 102 through 107. And really, this is all that has been going on has been building towards Psalm 107. This is just a fantastic psalm that summarizes everything we've been talking about. It talks about the great wondrous works of Yahweh. It picks up from 106, even though 106 ends book 4, and then we have a new book in the Psalms, book 5. And so there's some separation there. It picks up right where book 4 left off. If you remember in Psalm 106, verse 47, in light of this great meditation on the absolute rebellious nature of humankind, we end with this prayer of, "Save us, O Lord." Save us. At the end of the meditation, at the recollection of history and of their story and the story of their forefathers and just looking at this world, that is the basic cry that we come to. Simply, Lord, save us, save me, we need you. And the book ends, and there's kind of this pause. And then we get Psalm 107, which begins the same way that 106 does. Oh, give thanks to Yahweh, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of Yahweh say so, whom he has redeemed from trouble and gathered in from the lands, from the east and from the west and from the north and from the south. And it sets up the answer to the prayer in Psalm 106. Psalm 107 describes, here's how God has gone about his salvation, his great answer to the cry out of his people in verse 47, save us, save me. And so this psalm is brilliantly designed to lead us through a meditation on God redeeming. And the psalm is designed in this way. There's kind of two bookends. The first is what we just read. The redeemed are called to thanksgiving. We are a group of redeemed people, are we not? And yet, when we come to church, oftentimes we're not ready to give thanks. You ever notice that? You begrudgingly walk through the heat of the parking lot. Can't believe I'm here again. This place stinks. Literally, there's a smell. Person took your seat, whatever it is. All the little things that get at us, and yet the Psalms recognize that and call the redeemed, the very ones who've been rescued by this great God, who have been in their own place of being at their wits' end, just like Brady, come to this place of darkness and wanting to end it all, and yet we've been redeemed and rescued, and we are called into thanksgiving. There's a readiness about the people of God to give thanks. Amen? This psalm ends with this great statement about God's power to redeem through these metaphors of reversals. And we'll see the importance of those as we move through. But in the middle, there's these four stories, these four sections that the psalm intelligently goes through to describe the various people that God has redeemed and giving brief summary statements about the nature of that salvation. And in these stories, there's the same rhythm, the same structure. It's poetic, and so it follows this kind of rhythm that you'll be able to follow as we read, but the sections always begin with the phrase some, and then it will describe the group of people that it's talking about. It will give their desperate situation, and then it will say, they cried to Yahweh, and he delivered them from their distress. That verse is repeated in every story. It's repeated four times. And then the final phrase then is repeated four times. Let them thank Yahweh for his steadfast love, for his wondrous works. And the point of this whole structure is not to necessarily just give you one group to identify with, even though you might, as we go through, you might say, man, that really was me, that's my story, or that is me. The point is that there are all these different kinds of stories to show one thing, that life apart from God leads only to serious distress. And yet God wants to redeem out of that distress. That's the point of all four of these stories and talking and describing these four groups. And so we are as a human race, are in this life of choosing to live apart from God. That's what humans have chosen. And that life only leads to more death and destruction and despair. No matter what problems arise, we think we can come up with a solution and we don't. We just get further and further into our destructive tendencies because we're trying to live apart from Yahweh. We're living independently of Him. And God is redeeming and rescuing the people that in that moment of realizing that rebellion, crying out to the Lord, these are the people that He has redeemed. He rescues. He rescues into a life of dependence. Trying to live life apart from His character and His gifts will only lead to further destruction. So we're just going to see that in these four great stories, great articulations, starting in verse 4. Some wandered in desert wastes. And so this first group is the wanderer retrieved, we'll say. Some wandered in desert wastes, finding no way to a city to dwell in. Hungry and thirsty, their soul fainted within them. Then they cried to Yahweh in their trouble, and He delivered them from their distress. He led them by a straight way till they reached a city to dwell in. Let them thank Yahweh for His steadfast love, for His wondrous works to the children of man. For He satisfies the longing soul, and the hungry soul He fills with good things. This section describes the wandering soul. They are homeless, they are lost, they are hungry, thirsty, and they are exhausted in their soul. The end of verse 5, their soul fainted within them. And so it's not just about an actual physical wandering. There's a deeper soul thing happen. And using this metaphor of wandering to describe that point where we come to the end of ourself. And it's not necessarily this person's fault. We don't know. It could be. It could not be. The point is that they're wandering, searching and looking, and they've lost their way, and they can't get out of it. They can't find a city to dwell in. They can't find a safe place. They can't find a home. Finally, in their desperation, they cry to the Lord and He delivers them. He leads a course correction. Verse 7, He led them by a straight way. And so they've cried out to the Lord and they've begun now to be led by Him and to follow Him. It's not just that God plucked them up out of their wandering and put them into a safe place, but He led them on a journey to that safe place. And that's a critical thing, that they have now engaged in listening and engaging with the counsel of God in a place of obedience and submission and dependence upon Him. That's the story of redemption, going from independence, wandering, trying to do things on your own, turning to the Lord and letting Him lead you and guide you and actually listening to His leadership and engaging in His counsel. Life lived apart from the pursuit of Yahweh will leave us only with a longing soul, where you will feel hungry, thirsty, exhausted, without a home, a place of rest, without an identity. Jesus, when He shows up, knows this. And He addresses each of those things. To the lost, He says, I'm the way. To the hungry, He says, I'm the bread of life. To the thirsty, He says, come to me and you'll have fountains of living water flowing out of you. He says, come to me all who are weary and I will give you rest. He goes on to say that His followers are actually temples. That the Holy Spirit, God the Holy Spirit, fully indwells His children. What an identity. What a home. You're no longer homeless, but you've become God's home. Jesus speaks to the wanderer. He seeks to redeem. He seeks to retrieve. We all have a longing in our soul to be with God. And He's the only one that can satisfy that longing. Verse 9. For God satisfies the longing soul and the hungry soul he fills with good things. Amen? This room is full of people that were hungry or that go through moments of rebellion or just walking away and feeling all of a sudden that hunger and thirst and, oh man, I'm exhausted. And crying out to the Lord, God, save us. The cry of Psalm 106, save me. I need you. And God coming in and restoring, giving you a course correction and leading you and you re-engaging a relationship with him. And so let us indeed thank Yahweh for his steadfast love. What a wonderful work he has done in your life to redeem you. Amen? He's done a wonderful work in this room. He's gathered us here. Verse 10 through 16 gives the second group. Some sat in darkness in the shadow of death, meaning near death, right there at death. Prisoners in affliction and in irons, for they had rebelled against the words of God and spurned the counsel of the Most High. And so he bowed their hearts down with hard labor. They fell down with none to help. This section describes the rebellious soul. It's characterized by guilt, by darkness, by grinding toil, by doors of bronze and bars of iron. There's an imprisonment. And so this is about the prisoner set free. Another way of understanding God's redemption is to understand that we're prisoners, stuck, lonely, isolated, without any sense of hope. And maybe the worst part about it is that the imprisonment is their own fault. Not only have they rebelled, but they've actually spurned the counsel of the Most High. They knew the right way, and yet they didn't take the path. So they can even look at the first group, and they see those people along the way, and they say, no, that's not the path for me. And they made that choice because they didn't like the truth that God spoke, or they didn't like the means by which it came, because it came from someone they didn't like, or it came in a way that was just abrasive, or it just came in a way where they weren't ready to feeling ready to hear it. Whatever it is, they spurned the counsel from God. And so they started their own path, independent from the Lord. In an effort to unchain themselves from Yahweh, they only found more imprisonment and enslavement. And so he bowed their hearts down with hard labor. They fell down with none to help. Then they cried to Yahweh in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He brought them out of darkness and the shadow of death and burst their bonds apart. Let them thank the Lord for his steadfast love, for his wondrous works to the children of man. For he shatters the doors of bronze and cuts in two the bars of iron. These people are left feeling helpless, like their life is unfixable. They're so stuck in their rebellion. They've gotten so lost in it that they can't get out. It's like they're just entrapped and imprisoned, and they have seen how they've made this prison for themselves. You'll hear Alicia's story at the end of our time where she feels like the situation or even her personality was just unfixable. Desperation. It's a lonely, dark place. Then to verse 12, they fell down with none to help. But God dramatically saves them as they cry out to him. And it is dramatic. The images are strong. He brought them out. He burst their bonds apart. And he shatters the doors of bronze. And he cuts in two the bars of iron. There's great rescue and love as God speaks his truth to his people. There's great rescue and love when you cry out to the Lord. Do you long for that freedom? Are you feeling, maybe you're here today and you're feeling that imprisonment. You're feeling stuck. And Jesus knows that because he knows the plight of humanity is that they're living independently from the Lord, and he knows that that means you're going to end up in that situation of being stuck, feeling like you can't get out. And so in John 8, he simply says this, if you're really my followers, then you'll know the truth. And what's the truth going to do? It's going to set you free. The truth that Jesus wants to tell you, in your path of spurning his counsel, whether you actually knew you were doing that or not, He's going to come and speak his gracious truth to you. The truth that your sins are forgiven by the blood of Jesus Christ is absolutely freeing. When you are stuck like this, that's why we proclaim that truth. That's why we're here, is we've all been in that stuck place. Even in our own Christianity, in our walk of following Jesus, we've kind of wandered away and we come to that place of being stuck and we have to re-realize the gospel. He wakes us up and see the gospel afresh. Knowing the truth will set you free. So let us indeed thank Yahweh for his steadfast love. What wonderful work he's done to redeem us. Amen. The next section, verse 17 through 22, talks about how the sick are restored. Listen how it talks about this sickness. Some were fools. So we've got wanderers, we've got prisoners, and now we have fools. Some were fools through their sinful ways because of their iniquities, suffered affliction. They loathed any kind of food, and they drew near to the gates of death. Then they cried to Yahweh in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He sent out his word, and he healed them and delivered them from their destruction. Let them thank Yahweh for his steadfast love, for his wondrous works to the children of man, and let them offer sacrifices of thanksgiving and tell of his deeds in songs of joy. This section describes the foolish soul who has become sick. Biblically, the fool is not an unintelligent person. It is a person who is unwise. It is a person who is selflessly and impulsively trying to fix their temporary situations for temporary gain, neglecting long-term things and neglecting the benefit of other people. It's a person who simply acts for his own temporary alleviation rather than permanent satisfaction. And this pursuit brings about a sickness, and not just one of physical sickness, but a deep need for healing. They think wisdom is about getting ahead without getting caught. And yet they keep finding themselves in places where they're caught. And the sickness is their fault, brought on by their own foolishness of pursuing life apart from God, and they know it, they feel that, and they don't know what to do. It's a self-inflicted trouble, just like the previous of the rebels above. It's a self-inflicted. COVID has made us understand this kind of sickness. It's given us a great illustration. When you get COVID, it's like 2.5 weeks of quarantine, and no one comes and visits you. And our world has had to watch loved ones be alone in hospital rooms. Untouchable. Lonely. That's a great illustration of what this is talking about. And that experience of darkness and loneliness when you come to the end of yourself and you find yourself, like Brady said, not just not wanting to love others, but you feel unlovable. You see, that's where the pursuit of life apart from Yahweh takes you, into that zone. And so our foolishness can leave us feeling isolated, unlovable, but God has not left you. God has not left you. God actually sees you. And he's seen other people who are in your exact situation, and he even wrote about it 2,500 years ago. He sees you. He has not left you. He is ready to deliver you. Cry out the prayer, "Save me, Lord. Help me. Lord, I need you." And God will deliver. He will show up and he will give you songs of joy. Jesus did this all the time. And this is often the underlying thing behind a healing. When he heals someone, oftentimes he talks about forgiving them of their sin. This is a deeper thing going on than Jesus healing someone. And think of John 5, And the guy by the pool, he was just trying for a number of years to get to that pool so that the waters would heal him, but no one would take him down there. Everybody's rushing in front of him. I can't imagine the desperation he felt in his sickness to get healing and the kinds of thing going on in his soul. And Jesus shows up and simply just asks, do you want to be healed? And the guy's like, yeah, will you take me into the water? And Jesus is like, I'll do you one better. Get up and walk. It's not about the water. It's about meeting with Jesus. He heals, and he heals quickly. Amen? He will meet you. So God has not left you. He has showed up. Think about the post-resurrection encounters he had with his disciples. So there you have people that have been following Jesus for a while. And yet at the moment of Jesus' greatest suffering, they were not there. They ran. They lost faith. They went back to their old ways. And what did Jesus do in his post-resurrection appearances? There were no speeches about you got what you deserved or you should have done this or this. Jesus shows up and he restores them. Think of John 21 where he meets with Peter while Peter has gone back to fishing. And he speaks life. He speaks restoration. So we've experienced that and we will continue to experience Jesus' healing and restoration. What a beautiful thing it is. Let us indeed thank Yahweh for his steadfast love. He is doing a wonderful work among us. Amen. The final group is a little bit different. Some went down to the sea in ships doing business on the great waters. They saw the deeds of Yahweh, his wondrous works in the deep. For he commanded and raised the stormy wind, which lifted up the waves of the sea. They mounted up to heaven. They went down to the depths. Their courage melted away in their evil plight. They reeled and staggered like drunken men and were at their wits' end. Normal life has taken them to this moment. This is not about being necessarily in a state of rebellion. It is just about the idea that even living in this world, you will realize your smallness. That we human beings, no matter what kind of careful planning we have, no matter what kind of investments we make, no matter how well you plan out your path on the ocean, no matter how much you can read the storms and all those sorts of things, you will face things that you cannot defeat. You will be at your wit's end. And what a great summary of all of these stories where we are taken just by normal life even. This isn't necessarily their fault. There's no sign in the text that they're necessarily rebelling against God. They just have gone down here to try to make their way. And in the midst of that, they come up against their own limitations. They recognize their need for God and their need to depend upon him. That no matter what you do, you can plan, invest, you can do all the Bible studies, you can do all the memory verses, there's still going to be moments in your life where you come to your wit's end because we are dealing with things that are much bigger and outside of our control. Verse 28, then they cried to Yahweh in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He made the storm be still, and the waves of the sea were hushed. And they were glad when the waters were quiet. And he brought them to their desired haven. Let them thank Yahweh for his steadfast love, for his wondrous works to the children of man. Let them extol him in the congregation of the people and praise him in the assembly of the elders. So not is it just a personal thanksgiving, but there is a reality and an important practice that as you experience this type of redemption, that it must be told to the congregation. It must be told to the assembly. That's a big piece of church life. And so this is about rescuing the storm-tossed. We come to our wit's end many times in life simply because we're encountering God's big creation, that he rules. We're not in control of it, and we're not in control of him. He is free, and he is in charge. Jesus demonstrates this, of course. It's like the New Testament knows this passage exists. It's like Jesus knows this exists because they're out on the boat and they're just following Jesus and a huge storm comes up. And Jesus is still asleep, which is an amazing thing. That's some kind of trust or some kind of exhaustion. I have no idea what that is. And his disciples, who many were experienced sailors, could not defeat the storm. And what did they do? They shook Jesus awake. You ever feel like you have to do that to the Lord? See me, Lord. What are you doing, Jesus? Don't you care? That's a prayer of crying out. That's in the vein of Psalm 106, verse 47. Save us! And what did Jesus do? He woke up, he stood up, and he calmed the sea like that. It's incredible. It's exactly what this psalm is talking about. And then he also teaches his disciples a lesson, which is simply just to trust him. This is about dependence upon the Lord and nothing else. So some of you today are facing situations that are completely outside of your control and problems that are way too big to solve. Things beyond your comprehension, things that you have tried to understand, you can't. How did I get here? What happened? What's going on? Let me do this. Let me do this. Let me try to figure this out. Let me try to avoid this. And yet the situation remains unsolvable. And the point of this is not that God will calm the storms of your life. The point is that he is demonstrating his authority and power that we are submitting to, that we live life under his authority, not the other way around. He is not just some God that will show up whenever you ask him to so that he could come in and fix your little circumstance, maybe at the expense of other people. Who knows? You're not even thinking about that. You just know your situation. God, come in and help me. Who cares about the rest? I need rescue. This circumstance stinks. It's not about God coming in and doing that. It's about recognizing who's in charge. He's the one who rules creation. And as you come to your wit's end, the point is to submit to his leadership and rule and his counsel. He will lead you. He will provide safe haven. Again and again. And so these are the four stories that come to this conclusion in verse 33. Talking about God. He turns rivers into a desert and springs of water into thirsty ground, a fruitful land into a salty waste. Those aren't images that we're expecting. We're expecting the opposite. But that's because we're not thinking of God and his authority and his freedom. This is what he does. He rules creation. And he brings about reversals for his purposes. Because of the evil of its inhabitants, he turns a desert into pools of water and parched land into springs of water. And there he lets the hungry dwell, and they establish a city to live in. They sow fields and plant vineyards and get a fruitful yield, not by their own work and not because Yahweh's apart from them, but because of his provision, they were able to do this. By his blessing, they multiply greatly, and he does not let their livestock diminish. But when they are diminished and brought low through oppression, evil, and sorrow, he pours contempt on princes, meaning all this stuff with all the kings of Assyria and kings of Judah and Israel and Babylon and all these rulers that pridefully go after their own selfish empire building and destroy and oppress. God pours contempt on them. He deals with it in his own timing. He's bringing the rise and fall of nations, but he raises up the needy out of affliction and makes their families like flocks, and the upright see it and glad, and all wickedness shuts its mouth. God brings about dramatic reversals to accomplish his deeper purposes. And he's calling us to be in partnership with him, and he's working on these things now. He brings dramatic change to the course of our lives if we keep pursuing him, if we follow his counsel. We'll spend the next couple of weeks talking about what that counsel is, but let me just read this final verse and give two quick applications. Verse 43, whoever is wise, let him attend to these things. Let them consider the steadfast love of the Lord. That's the conclusion of Psalm 102 to 107. This basic thing. Whoever's wise, if you want wisdom, you should think about Psalm 102 to 107. You should think about God's works and what he's doing. And it will yield you, I think, to these two applications that Psalm 107 is presenting before us, but all the Psalms have been, these have been key themes. First of all, cry out to Jesus. As you meditate on the work of the Lord and his character and seek to understand him, cry out to him. It's the prayer of Psalm 106, verse 47. Simply, save me. I need you. And like Brady in his story, he cried out to the Lord, and then miraculously people started showing up. Did you see that? And you'll see that in Alicia's story in just a second. God will send his workers to you, and they will start saying things to you. And so cry out to Jesus. We live in a world where God is actively and miraculously involved, changing people's hearts for his glory. And so no matter what your situation is, no matter how far away you feel or how close you feel, there's a moment of crying out to Jesus. And so is this your moment? Some of you are in one of these situations. Many of us are in these situations. Is this your moment to cry out to him? I hope that it is. That's why you're here today. Thanks for taking that first step of coming here. This is part of crying out to the Lord, but there's a prayer. Ask him to save you. Ask him to help you. In the midst of your loneliness and weariness, God is ready and willing to help. I think this is important because we've been talking a lot about how our culture is going downhill and our country is going downhill, which is the right observation. Our world, as we look at it, is sinking away from the Lord. We are wanting to increase our independence from the Lord. And so we keep making that observation, we keep talking about it, and the danger of that is that it can breed a lot of anger and frustration towards people. And unfortunately, we see a lot of that. And we see a lot of that in our own hearts. It's leading just to frustration. Man, these people, you're making those types of statements, I'm making those types of statements. And yet when we look at Psalm 107 and the course correction it gives us, it says, okay, yeah, that might be the right observation. In fact, Jesus said the world's going to get worse before he comes. So none of this is surprising to the Lord. And then we look at Psalm 107, and what's God doing in the midst of the world sliding into independence from him? He is looking and listening and waiting for people to cry out to him and wanting to meet people in their times of need, and he's using you and I to do that work. And that's the lens. And so let our conversations about how our culture is going downhill or our country or our world, whatever it is, let that move us to praying for the harvest, for praying for people to hear about the Lord. Really, people are in need of hearing about him and his loving plan of redeeming them. God wants to rescue. God wants to rescue. So we need Jesus. We're wandering, we're stuck in chains, we're sick, we're storm-tossed. We are stuck in our sin, and Jesus is our Savior. If you don't know that this morning, let me just tell you, Jesus is your Savior. Cry out to him. Cry out to him. If he is your Savior, and you've been walking with him for a while, and yet you find yourself stuck, cry out to him. The prayer of verse 47, 106 is very simple. Save me, O Lord my God. And watch how he answers. Second, maturity is measured by thanksgiving. Often we think maturity is measured by our level of self-sufficiency, and that is not what Psalm 107 says. It is pushing us towards greater thanksgiving and towards a life of thanksgiving. That as we experience this great redemption, it is to move us not away from the Lord and say, okay, Lord, now I've got this. You've rescued me once, now I can do it. You've saved me once, let me earn and show you that your mercy towards me was worth it. That's not the life. The life is simply entering into the gratitude of God and his redeeming of you and of the people. And that's an amazing journey to be on. And so Psalm 107 grounds us in the importance of hearing about God's wondrous works and thanking him for it. As you hear other people being redeemed, that drives us to give gratitude. And so let us not sit in the rhythms of anger and frustration. If we play back the thoughts of our day, let it be thanksgiving towards the Lord. So are you ready to give thanks? Are you ready to give thanks? This is not optimism or pessimism, it's realism. This is really what's going on. What Psalm 107 tells us about the world and about human experience is really what's going on. God is ready to redeem. We want to hear another testimony from Alicia. She's been in our church for a couple of years, and God has just done some amazing things in her life. And then we'll sing a couple songs just by way of thanking and praising the Lord. Again, this is not to make a celebrity out of people. It's to drive us towards gratitude for his great love and for his miraculous involvement in the lives of individuals. Amen? Let's pray. God, would you continue to meet with us and encourage us as we hear about your work and as we sing about your character. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hi, my name is Alicia, and I've been attending Red Mountain for about a year and a half now. I was fortunate enough to grow up in a home where the Bible was read and memorized together as a family, and I'm so grateful for that foundation. But still, as a child, I experienced a lot of guilt and shame, as if I was walking around knowing I had done something wrong, but not knowing exactly what it was. I also struggled to make friends. My dad was in the military, so we moved around a few times, and I was homeschooled, so I only attended the public school for sports or a few classes here and there. I was also a pretty shy kid. When I graduated high school, I thought I would finally have the chance to find a place where I could really fit in. I attended a small Christian university where I could continue playing multiple sports. I was also majoring in civil engineering with high hopes of saving the world one road and bridge at a time. Unfortunately, I experienced a lot of disappointment. I still struggled to make friends, and for the first time in my life, I wasn't a straight A student. At the end of the school year, I found a group of people I thought I might fit in with. But then the drinking started. As the pressure of finals hit, my friends and I made some poor choices that got me into a situation where I was sexually assaulted. I went home from school that spring, totally crushed under the weight of depression, and that continued into my sophomore year. I transferred to a local public university that was closer to home, and I knew I wanted to live differently, so I got involved with the campus ministry. But still, the drinking continued, and in my own way, I sought to regain the control that I felt I had lost when I was assaulted by hooking up with men that I barely knew. All these attempts to feel better only led me deeper into shame, depression, and self-loathing. I knew that what I was doing was wrong, but I felt so stuck. Finally, I hit rock bottom. I had lost most of my friends, and in a conversation with one of my friends who I'd hurt the most, I admitted that I felt like I was just never going to get it right. When she agreed with that sentiment, it felt like a kick in the gut. I knew in that moment that I needed to find a new way to live, or I could not keep living. In the midst of my despair, I got in touch with a staff person from the campus ministry. She sat down with me and listened to me just pour out my heart for about 3 hours. And then she asked me a simple question. She said, "Alicia, do you think that God was disappointed with your mistakes?" And that really struck me because I knew the answer technically was no. I had asked Jesus to be my savior as a child, and I believed I was forgiven. If God truly had forgiven me, he couldn't hold my sin against me. But I realized that I had been living as if God was disappointed with me. Finally, I started to understand grace in a new way and my identity in Christ. That my value isn't determined by my performance, whether success or failure. As I started to beat myself up less over my sin and to live in the reality of God's forgiveness for me, I started to experience more and more freedom from that sin. I also experienced a lot of growth and healing in community as I got more involved with the campus ministry. Even still, I find that most of my growth happens in community. And God has been so good and faithful to bring me into the right community at the right time. Now he's led me into a marriage with a husband that I'm so grateful for. And God has continued to use that relationship in growing and healing me even more. And I'm only just a few months in.